any of you have either worked or know somebody that exhibits any or all of these examples? Somebody who maybe criticizes others when they make mistakes, who is always the victim, never their fault, it's always somebody else's issue, somebody who is maybe a little bit passive-aggressive, maybe doesn't feel very open, understanding or taking critical feedback, maybe really just doesn't care what other people think, really only interested in their own self-opinions. So, I'm sure most of us have met at least one or two people, hopefully you're not working for anyone this summer, that exhibit some of these qualities. But if you've met somebody, you're working with somebody who exhibits some of these, then you've probably worked with somebody who has lower emotional intelligence. So, let's look at the opposite, and somebody who has high emotional intelligence exhibits very different traits from somebody who exhibits low emotional intelligence. They are good at managing their emotions. If they're in a stressful situation, they take a breath, they're calm, they know how to handle that situation. They take feedback, they're open to it. They're willing to actually look at themselves honestly and think about what they've learned. They're able to sense the needs of others. Hopefully you've also had the experience of working with somebody, whether it's in a project or an employer who exhibits these traits. Maybe you see some of these traits in yourself. So today's agenda, we're going to go into a high-level overview of what emotional intelligence is. We're going to talk about why it's beneficial for you to develop your own emotional intelligence. You'll get to find out how you rate on an emotional intelligence scale and how you can improve that emotional intelligence. So let's look at the formal definition before we start today. This was from Goleman and in 1998. So I'm going to say, if you are doing any sort of Googling on emotional intelligence, you will also find a variety of different definitions. And I think all of them are very similar. They have slightly different components to them. This is the one that I like the best. The formal definition is emotional intelligence is the capacity for understanding our own feelings, the feelings of others, for being able to motivate ourselves, and for being able to manage our emotion effectively in relationships. Okay? Why is this important? Why are we talking about emotional intelligence at a professional development workshop? Is this going to enhance your technical skills? No. But will this play an important role in your full-time job search? Absolutely. And in fact, CareerBuilder did a survey of more than 2,600 hiring managers and human resources professionals and found out that 71% of employers value that emotional intelligence over a high IQ. Now, many of you are here at a top university, studying very challenging majors, working very hard to be very proficient at the subject matter that you're studying, and that is important. But what's also important is how you interact with others. Of those who have high emotional intelligence, they make $28,000 more annually than those with lower emotional intelligence. I like money. Anyone else here in the room like money? Hey, yeah. All right. Emotional intelligence is actually responsible for about 58% of the way you perform on that job. So whether you're coding, or you're working on projects, or you're working with a team, it's not your own intellectual ability that's moving you forward in that. It's your ability to interact with others and to be able to manage your emotions through that project. And if you look at top performers, people that are famous, that are well known for being great at what they do, most of them have high emotional intelligence, and that's what's led to their success. How many of you knew that you will be probably changing jobs on average 8 to 12 times in your lifetime? It's pretty significant. You're going to be doing a lot of jumping around. And that's why it's important for you to have good emotional intelligence, because people with high EI have more opportunities available to them. When you're looking for job number two, the connections that you've built in your first job are going to give you better opportunities for your next job. People with high emotional intelligence have earned the trust of others. So if they make a mistake, if they screw up, people are more forgiving and they're more understanding. They are effective leaders. They're able to possess a long-term vision. And finally, people with high emotional intelligence can read people better, and they can understand situations better. All of these skills lead to those opportunities for you to be able to grow in your career. I love this quote here. Your IQ will get you hired, but it's your EI that will get you promoted. So many of you will be graduating in the next few years, maybe this upcoming year, and will be looking for that first job. How many of you are planning to stay in that first role at your first job for the rest of your career? Okay, nobody, right? Within a year or two, you're probably going to start thinking about, well, what's my next role? How do I grow in this position? How do I gain more responsibility? And while being good at the technical side of your job will be important for you to have that opportunity to grow, it's being able to work with the others, being able to effectively manage up, as we like to say, that's going to put you in a position to be promoted. Okay, so we're going to do a little bit of a dive into the four domains of emotional intelligence before we get to do your assessment. So there are four main areas in emotional intelligence. At the top, you'll see self-awareness. Self-awareness is really your ability to know yourself, to understand your emotions, to know what your strengths are, what your weaknesses are. It's for you also to be able to have self-confidence. If you know yourself, you know what you're good at. The second domain is self-management as we move over here. So once you know your emotions, you know your strengths, your weaknesses, you must effectively be able to manage those in a variety of situations. If you know that sometimes you're hot-headed and that you can quickly react to a situation, if you know that that's a problem that you have or a struggle that you have, being able to manage that, being able to know, okay, I don't like what they said, I'm not going to jump off, you know, and start in on that person, I'm going to take a deep breath, I know how to manage that. That's what self-management is. Social awareness is being able to understand others, being able to understand their emotions, their feelings, having empathy for what your colleagues and what your coworkers are going through. Relationship management, I think this is probably the trickiest domain because it really relies on you being able to utilize the other domains effectively, to be able to know how you feel, know your emotions, know how others feel, know their emotions, and be able to navigate that successfully as you build relationships with others. So that's your relationship management component. Okay, so this is just a slightly different view of what is entailed in each of the domains. So self-awareness, as we said, that's really being knowledgeable about your own emotions. Self-management is, again, being able to not only control your emotions, but control your outlook. Has anyone ever come to work and you're having just a crappy day, and you take it out on everyone, you know, you're just stomping around, kind of grumping, you're not greeting people friendly. Did you know that takes a toll on the people that you're working with? You are impacting your work environment, and that's what we're talking about with self-management, is knowing that, hey, I'm having a crappy day, but you know what, I'm not gonna let this impact other people, I'm not gonna let this impact my work environment. Social awareness, again, that's really being concerned with the people that you're working with, being able to understand their thoughts, their views, what they're going through, maybe their personal challenges. And then finally, with relationship management, there's a lot of components within this one, but first and foremost, it's being able to influence others, because you're able to read a situation, understand what would be the right approach or the right thing to say or do in that particular environment, and that leads you to be able to effectively be a coach and a mentor, to be able to work in an environment maybe where there's conflict and you're able to resolve that, and to be effective in a team environment and to be able to motivate others. So that's your high-level overview of emotional intelligence. Now we're going to talk a little bit about some examples of emotional intelligence in the workplace. This quote was taken a few years back from Jeff Bezos about how he hires for Amazon. He very specifically looks at emotional intelligence in the hiring process. As you can see from this quote here, that setting the bar high in our approach to hiring has been and will continue to be the single most important element of Amazon's success. It wasn't hiring the smartest people out there. It wasn't hiring the top talent who could bring the new technical skills. It was hiring the right member for their team. The people that could take that ability to come up with new ideas, new products, sell those ideas, work with that team to effectively implement them. So hopefully these faces here are familiar to you. These are people that are known to have high emotional intelligence. We've already talked a little bit about Jeff. He is just obsessed with the people that work for his company and the customers they served. Oprah, I think she's probably one of the people that is best known for her emotional intelligence. Her ability to make a fool of herself by crying and cheering and jumping up and down as she relates to her celebrity guests, she's known for that. Just the same, she can reach out to an average audience member and connect with them in a dynamic way. She's able to read people and read situations. And one that maybe might be slightly less familiar to you is Warren Buffett. I worked in one of his companies when I was a college student. It's very glamorous. It's called Dairy Queen. Yes, I know. The things we do. But my boss actually was a shareholder. And Warren Buffett himself came to the annual shareholders meetings, of course, in Omaha, Nebraska, and was so personable and so caring about the owners of his franchisors. He encouraged them all to think about owning a company as if they would still own that company 100 years from that day. So really investing in the people and the ideas behind the company. So you can see we're having high emotional intelligence, how they're applied in different industries, but leads to really effective relationship development. Some other benefits of having high emotional intelligence within a workplace means that your teamwork improves. If you work with people who have high EI, you're able to communicate effectively. You're able to tackle a project. You're able to be open and honest about pros and cons, challenges that you're facing, because change is embraced. People are willing to take that feedback and will be willing to say, well, yeah, that's not what I was thinking, but I see your point. Let's try it your way this time. They're able to handle these tough situations, and if you're working in an environment where you have customers, and sometimes customers are internal, sometimes customers are external, there's better environment and better service for those customers when your team is functioning with high emotional intelligence. Okay, so here's the fun part. This is the part where you get to find out on a high level what your emotional intelligence is. So we've got some quizzes that are gonna come around. So probably take you about 2 minutes. It's a really quick quiz. You'll just go with your gut reaction. As you complete the quiz, circle your own rating on each individual skill I've listed. And remember, rate yourself honestly. This is not what you hope to be or what you wish you were, but think honestly about the things that you do naturally do and things that maybe are more challenging to you. So go ahead and take just a couple minutes to complete this. And after you complete it, you can go ahead and add your total score and put that at the bottom. You'll just count up each number ranking, and then we'll be able to rank your domains on the back as well. You're gonna walk away and magically improve your emotional intelligence. It is an active process that you'll want to engage in. So if self-awareness is one that you personally would like to work on, here are some of the few things that you can do. First and foremost, I think, again, thinking about your mood and how you project your mood in your work environment or in the classroom or when you're on a team project. If you're having trouble understanding your moods, then one of the things that I would recommend you doing is keeping a journal. Maybe you journal for a few minutes each morning when you wake up. Think about what you have going on in that day, thinking about how you're feeling about what's going on that day, or maybe you do it at the end of the day, or over your lunch break. So really actively thinking about how you're feeling about things in your life. That helps us connect to our emotions. Okay, self-regulation. So again, self-regulation is that challenge of staying in control of your emotions, not just knowing them, but being able to manage them effectively. Is it appropriate to jump up and down and scream when you found out that you just got the dream job offer? Absolutely. Is it appropriate in a work environment to slam a door, yell at your coworker, or berate someone else because you're not happy with a promotion that they received that you didn't get? No, right? I mean, that's going to quickly lead you probably down to HR to have a conversation about appropriate work behavior. So thinking about when is it appropriate to demonstrate good or bad emotions in the workplace. Okay, so if this is one that you struggle with, here are some of the things that maybe you find challenging. Do you find yourself maybe getting upset easily and not really having an avenue to get rid of that anger? Sometimes we off the cuff say things that we don't mean to say, or maybe are offensive to the others that we're saying them to. We don't think before we speak, or we don't think before we act. Maybe you find it really challenging to be able to take negative feedback and be able to take that and process it and move forward with that. Maybe you get stuck in that, ugh, she said I suck, you know, and you don't think about, well, you know, what she said is true. Maybe I'm not doing those things, and you know what, I could probably be more successful if I was able to implement some of those suggestions. And finally, again, struggling to remain calm if you're in a stressful situation. Okay, so some of the things that we can do if self-regulation is a domain that you'd like to work on is pausing. Pausing is, I think, probably one of the best tools that most people do not take advantage of. Here in the U.S., we are uncomfortable with silence. We like to fill it. We feel like we should always be on demand, ready with an answer at all times, especially if we're talking to our boss. But one of the best tools that you can use when you are given feedback, when you're given a new project, when you're having a conversation, is to take a moment and think a little bit about, what do I think about this? Well, I don't like this, but now how can I present my arguments in a way that's clearly effective and not unthoughtful or hurtful to others? So taking that moment to really think through before you jump in to respond to a request, to feedback. So taking that pause. The second thing I would recommend then is simply just practicing being calm. If you've ever been in a meeting where somebody attacks your ideas and you feel like immediately you need to jump in, well, that's not true. What I meant is this. And you feel like you're really being defensive, this is where you can practice being calm, practice implementing, taking that deep breath, and then possibly removing yourself from the situation. If you feel like you're not able to get in control of your emotions, if you're really struggling with what feedback language, which means you should be making great eye contact with the person that you're talking to. Okay? And it says here, 93% of the message is that nonverbal contact. If you're having a conversation with a coworker and you've said, hey, you know what, I'm going to assign you to this project, can you go ahead and take this on? And the person you're talking to has their arms crossed, they're not looking down, I mean, they're looking down, they're not making eye contact with you, they're not smiling. And do you think they're excited about this project? To me, that nonverbal is not agreeing with their verbal, and especially if their verbal says, oh, it's fine, I'll go with the flow, I'll, you know, I'll add that to my workload, it's fine. Saying it's fine, I'll go with the flow, in theory says they're fine, they're gonna go with the flow, they're gonna do it, it's okay. But that combined with the looking down, it's fine, I can do it, I'll add it to my flow. If you're not paying attention to that nonverbal, you're not hearing what they're saying. They're not in agreement with that project. So that final piece, if you're being an active listener, is to acknowledge what you've heard. And what you've heard is not, hey, it sounds like you're really excited. Can't wait to get started on this project. You know what? Let me know how it goes. We'll check up in a week. What you've heard is, it sounds like you're not excited about this. Sounds like you might be frustrated about this. This is the first step of being able to show empathy, to be able to understand and show that you understand others, is to be an active listener and to be able to pay attention to the body language. Ask for more details, and then acknowledge what you've heard. And if you struggle to be an active listener, I know we all struggle some days with being a listener, these are a few things that you can keep in your back pocket to pull out. I think the hidden message is just really asking questions, asking for more information. If what you're hearing does not seem to be in agreement with what the person is demonstrating, then ask them to explain. Tell me more. do you see some issues with this? What should we be doing? Okay. And that final piece is that relationship management. And this is, again, this is a little bit more complicated, not one that we are going to master in the next 3 minutes or so today. But it's really being able to effectively work with people. And I think when you are a college student, whether you're an undergrad or a graduate student, this is definitely something that you will be working on as you work in teams and all of your projects. But many of us dread the team project, and it's because the hardest part of working with a team project is motivating others to get them to do their part, right? How many of us dread a team project? Because you know you're the person that's gonna have to do the work, okay? So if you develop good relationship management skills, you won't dread working in team projects anymore. So the most important piece that I can say is that you should actually devote time when you're working to develop those relationships with the people you work with. The more rapport you have with your colleagues, with your teammates, the better teammate they will be for you. You build that relationship with them. These are super easy things that you can do. Stopping by to say hello, chatting with them quickly, asking for their how their weekend went, supporting them on social media, if they posted something on LinkedIn. Being appreciative. Thanks so much for doing that. I really appreciate it. I know it took a lot of time. You did a great job with it. And motivating them. Hey, you did such a great job with that project last week. Do you want to do that? Do you want to do something similar? Do you think you could show Michael how to do that? Those things are really effective, and they take very minimal time for you to be able to start building those relationships with your colleagues. Okay, so today I'm asking you to think about what you can do if you have 10 minutes or 1 hour or even one full day to increase and to start building one domain of your emotional intelligence. Emotions drive people, but people drive performance. Investing in yourself and the people that you're working with will have a huge impact on the success of your career. All right. Thank you very much.